Hello everyone, this is Piero San Giorgio. I'm the author of several books. Hi from Switzerland. Today I'd like to do a short video to someone I admire and appreciate, and I encourage you to connect to his channels, especially his Patreon channel, which are really good. And this man is Pastor Joe Fox. He lives in the Ozark Mountains, and like me, when I'm not in my office, lives in the countryside and develops self-sustainability, grows his own food, and has very, very interesting views on life. And he has experience from the American Army Special Forces. In one of his recent videos, he talked about his willingness to build a nuclear shelter or a fallout shelter. And maybe he misspoke, or maybe he wasn't clear enough, but he made a little bit of some suggestions which I wanted to clarify. Why me? Well, because I wrote a book on CBRN preparation, how you prepare yourself for a chemical, biological, radiological, and of course, nuclear events. Nuclear events could be nuclear war. And Pastor Joe Fox has probably all the knowledge I'm going to tell you today. And of course, this video is for him. And so I speak to him very humbly, and I don't want to teach this gentleman, which has a lot of experience, anything. He probably knows this from his army training. But I would like to do this for him and for many others who are thinking about having whatever you call them, bunkers, nuclear shelters, fallout shelters, which are expensive and labor-consuming. You know, it takes a lot of time and money to an effort to build those things. And I would like to be precise on a few things. Why also, besides the fact that I wrote a book, I am Swiss and I live in Switzerland I've been living in Switzerland all my life, a country where everywhere you have nuclear and fallout shelters. Almost everywhere since 1950s, it was mandatory by law for every building, every house, every city building to have, every new building had to be had to have fallout and nuclear shelters. Now, why do you need those? Well, you have to take the thing in the other way around. Is what is a nuclear problem? Well, first of all, you could have a nuclear explosion. So, nuclear explosion could come by a nuclear bomb, whether it's a missile or a free fall bomb, whatever, doesn't matter, or if it's a dirty bomb that has been exploding. Well, obviously, the first concern you should have is, are you living near a target? Well, if you're in the Ozarks or in the mountains, unless there is a military base of strategic importance, this is not a target. So one of the great reasons to be away from the cities and far from major strategic bases such as airfields, logistical depot, logistical supply bases, which are probably more important than cities for the enemy to target, well, you will not have the problem of the nuclear explosion per se. Now, the nuclear explosion, obviously, as a big explosion, has effects of blast, and you don't want to be near that blast. You have effects of heat. Actually, the heat comes before the blast, which can cook you, kill you, of course. And then you have the effect of radiation. And of course, you have light, which can blind you, but it's part of the heat of the blast, really. The radiation of the nuclear explosion is out. If you understand how a nuclear warhead functions, is basically a set of explosives that explode simultaneously to compress the core of plutonium or other fissile material. That's the radioactive material. And by compressing them, but these powerful explosives compress this material into, so that the atoms, that they basically explode themselves and under that pressure, and they liberate the energy that they have stored physically inside them. And by exploding, that energy, usually it's what we call the gamma rays. Well, this is the radiation that kills you. And these gamma rays are they don't last very long, but they're very powerful. And they're usually absorbed by matter. And matter could be the air and the atmosphere, and it could be any layer of protection between you and the rain, of course. So if you are behind heavy walls and dense material, it's not really the weight, it's a density. So it's the atomic density. So if, for example, why is lead protective against these kind of rays? Well, because lead is a very dense metal, it's a very dense material. So the more you have stuff, the more you have dense materials between, so a layer of lead is better than a big pillow of feathers because the leather is more dense. So the more you have stuff, it can be a wall, it can be, so for example, a window is not very protective, but a big wall, if you're under the earth, underground, will protect you from these rays. These rays will destroy your cells and cook you from the inside. They will kill you. But they're not radioactive. It's a ray. You can imagine the explosion and phew, the ray will destroy the biological matter. It destroys your DNA, destroys the functioning of the cells in any living tissue in the range of those rays. Because these rays they don't radiate very far because they get absorbed by matter very quickly. You know, a few hundred meters of air, of oxygen, depending on the size, of course, of the explosion, usually will absorb and these rays are gone. So if you are near a blast, near a target, having a nuclear shelter is mostly to protect you from the blast, from the heat, from the light, and from these rays. So this is why in Switzerland, in every city, you have these deep concrete, reinforced concrete shelters. And I don't know in the US, but the terminology here is we call these nuclear bunkers. So they are supposed to protect you from those effects of a nuclear blast. So if someone wants to blast a city, the nuclear weapon goes off, you have light, heat, blast, and which can cause, of course, concussion and all that. And if you have the alarm and you go in the shelter, of course, you are sheltered from the heat, the blast, and of course, the rays, because the shelters are very thick and you have this very thick concrete. I will put a video just here that I made of my parents' house nuclear shelter, and you will see the size of the doors, which are steel concrete doors. They are probably, I don't know, this big, 40 centimeters. That's probably what, 12, 14 inch big size. And of course, if you live in the city, well, you better have, or if you live near a target, yes, you better have one of those, because, you know, if in case of there's a nuclear war, there is. The problem is it's super expensive in the city. Can you imagine to dig under your house such a shelter? And usually what we say in the book, what I explain in my book, CBRN, is that usually rather than dig a fully functional nuclear shelter, if you live, first of all, you should leave the cities and live outside of any strategic target area. But if you can't, well, you should reinforce your cellar. You go to the basement of your house and you reinforce the walls with sheets. If you don't have a lot of space, invest into some lead sheets or metal sheets and reinforce the place, because the radiations will fly straight. They will not seek you. They will fly straight and they don't bounce off. They just go through material. They go inside and they get absorbed and they disappear. So then you will ask, what about radiation? What about fallout? Well, radiation is not a gas. It's not a cloud. It's not something that flies away and then kills everyone. That's not how it works. What you call fallout, what is fallout, is not radiation in the air that falls. It's in fact that, remember, when the explosion goes off, that plutonium, or that core of uranium, but usually it's plutonium, that gets compressed and that explodes, it doesn't have a full combustion. It doesn't have a full, perfect destruction of that matter. Probably a few percent of that matter is actually used for the explosion itself, and the rest is actually not vaporized, but it's destroyed. And all these tiny elements of plutonium, they are into dust, into microscopic dust. And that dust, of course, with the explosion, with the heat, and all the other dust that is gathered by the explosion that does that famous and that, you know, that mushroom cloud that is so typical, well, it gets mixed with the dust, and you have these particles, nucleotides is the name of that, that are mixed with dust and are carried by the wind. And this is what we call fallout. So in fact, there's no creation of radiation. Is that this fissile material, which is dangerous, which is radioactive, as it always was, the plutonium is radioactive, and it's an unbalance within the atom of plutonium, of between the neutrons and the electrons. There is an imbalance, and that creates these little rays, not on a big distance. You will not die sitting 1 meter away from a tiny particle of plutonium. But if you touch it, your skin is contaminated and will burn. And of course, even a tiny amount of those particles, especially if you breathe them, can be deadly, can be mortal. And this is, by the way, what happens when a nuclear power plant explodes. It does not explode like a nuclear weapon, but because of the explosion, there's a dust containing these materials, usually in the nuclear plant. It's uranium, it's not plutonium. It's very low-grade uranium compared to the plutonium or the uranium that could be used in nuclear weapons. And so you have these little dusts that go in the air. And eventually they are carried by wind and they fall out. And this is what we call fallout. Now, how can you protect against that? Well, this is more complicated because fallout usually gets on the ground. You know, there's a half-life in a way. And maybe I shouldn't use that word because half-life is the technical terms of how radioactivity is reduced by two. So if you have uranium, which has a half-life, I don't know by heart, but maybe of 20 years, well, basically it means that the radioactivity generated by that uranium is reduced by two in 20 years, the half-life. So what happens with this dust of particles is that they fall, they're carried by winds, and they fall somewhere. And in this case, yes, even if you're in the Ozarks, even if you are in the countryside, you could be under the wind and get this fallout. Now, do you need a fallout shelter for these things? Well, not really. What you need is a shelter, in the sense that your house is a shelter. Your house could be airtight. Now, the question is, how do you know that there is fallout coming your way? This is the big question. Because you could have nuclear explosions quite far away and winds carrying that to you, and you might not, depending on the situation, you might not even know that there has been a nuclear war or a bomb going on. If that happens after communications have been shut down by an EMP or something else, or a big economic crisis or whatever, you don't know. So intelligence, knowing what is happening, is of course very important. Now, the next level is, if you know that there is fallout, well, in that case, even if it's not necessarily coming to your house, to your area, if you suspect fallout because there has been a nuclear war and many big cities have been destroyed, well, then what you should do is to plan to stay inside and shut tight every opening of your house until that fallout has fallen and is on the ground. And that is something that anyone can plan to do without needing to build an underground shelter, because shutting tight your house means shutting tight the windows so you can use tape. It means shutting down the little difference, you know, the openings between the door and the floor. You can check this today. You can check if your house is very tight or not. And usually, you know, there are gaps. So you plan ahead to have enough material, enough tape. It can be, you know, these gorilla type tape or these tapes that you use for electricity, these black tapes, or and And then you plan to have enough to cover all your house, to shut down everything tight, so that when the wind carries the fallout, these tiny particles, they fall, but they don't get blown inside your house. So you have to be careful. And yes, you should plan to stay inside for some time. And even better, if you have a ways to get out, to have not just one door, but to have a way to go through a room out, so that if you open one door, the wind doesn't blow these particles inside. Now, usually, after 1, maximum 2 weeks, the winds, the rains, they bring all of this down. And let's face it, if there is a nuclear exchange and your house will get will get fallout, just expect that you will get, unfortunately, some of those radiating particles, nucleotides, in your house and with you. It's just so hard to avoid all of them. But if you avoid most of them, it will probably not affect your health too much. And that is what we want to do. We want to limit that that health risk. So once you have your house tight, and once you have enough, indeed, food, water, and so on, to hold on inside for a while, and even better if you can do the same for whatever animals you have outside. And this is the problem. You have to get out to feed your animals, to tend them. So prepare, in that case, to have enough clothes that can be tight and that can be changed and probably thrown away or decontaminated, which is a process I'm going to go into. And because you can't leave your animals to die outside. You have at least to feed them and tend to them. And that's the problem. And of course, after a few days, after a week, probably maximum 2 weeks, the fallout is gone, because the winds will either carry it away or it is on the ground. And so at this point, you can get outside and you have to decontaminate everything that this dust has probably touched. So this means you need to have hoses, you need to have water, and you need to decontaminate yourself, you need to decontaminate the house. So of course, having rain would help, and be careful in that case not to gather rainwater in your whatever wells or whatever storage of water you have, because that water is carrying particles. And you don't want to use that water in your garden to give to your animals or to clean yourself, to wash yourself, or even to drink. That would be a huge mistake, because that water is full of tiny particles that are radioactive, that are still active, that they will kill you from the inside, and they will create burns and cancers and so on. And you need a tiny, you know, we have a lot of, by the way, we have a lot of studies, and I quote them in my book, on the effects of these particles in Ukraine and Belarus, which have been hit by the Chernobyl explosion disaster, nuclear plant explosion. And so we have a lot of experience on how we treat these hundreds of thousands of people and children, unfortunately, who have been contaminated in 1986, I think, was it. And so we know how to treat them. We know how to prepare food. We know how to. I'm going a bit too fast ahead. So first, decontaminate your house, your clothes, and so on. And then the problem will be how you decontaminate your soil. And you will have a tiny topsoil that, if there is fallout, you will probably have to throw away. You will probably have to set apart an area where you take all the topsoil, which is unfortunately some precious soil, but you will probably have to take an inch or two and get rid of it, because that's where the particles have arrived. And then animals and vegetables who are growing that year, you have to be very careful. If you have cabbage, throw away the external leaves, and the internal leaves will still be good if the fallout has fallen on some vegetables. We'll need to wash every fruit and vegetable from that season very thoroughly. And once again, remember, be careful of the water that you use. If you fear some fallout, make sure that whatever water storage, don't get new water from your roof and from elsewhere, because it could be contaminated. So having a lot of water storage is important in that scenario, more important than building a new shelter, if you see my train of thought. And then, of course, the animal food preparation, you have to be careful. usually when animals have been contaminated by such nucleotides as this dust, usually because they eat all that they eat grass that has the dust on it. Well, these particles will enter their body, their bloodstream, and so on. And usually, these particles they end up into the liver, in the bone marrow, and the filtration organs such as kidneys. And these are probably the organs of the meat of that animal that you shouldn't eat. So, if you have fear to have fallout in your area, don't eat marrow, bone. Don't eat the kidneys, and the rest of the meat. You should boil it. And they found out in Russia that if you boil water with salt, the salt and the hot water tend to attract the little particles, because on the chemical level, the way the salt is set up in terms of electrons and the atom does bind with the different types of radioactive material, which is cesium, strontium, and other kind of material. We're going to deep physics, which is beyond my pay grade. But they do bind. It's just the same way as, for example, if you use potassium iodine pills, they will fill your thyroid gland so that they don't gather cesium, which has almost the same atomic similarity, atomic structure. So you will have to take care of your animals and your garden to clean it, to decontaminate it. And it's a long and painful process. So we really hope, of course, that this never happens. But it could. It could. You know, since the 90s, we've never had nuclear war danger until now. We have it again. So be very careful. So the idea is that you have to understand the physics and the functioning of a nuclear blast, and of course the fallout that can come after, before you start a project, eventually, of having a shelter. Because if you live far away from any target, why would you need to build a hole in the ground and stay underground when you can just make tighten shut your house? Because there's no blast. There's not going to be that kind of heat and blast from an explosion. And honestly, no one is going to nuclearly target your farm out in the mountains, just as no one is going to target my farm with a nuclear weapon. These things are very expensive. However, you have to be, I think everyone should be prepared to manage fallout, getting your house tightly shut, having clothes that you can decontaminate. Those are special clothes and they're not expensive. Boots, gloves. I explain everything in the book. And these are simple items to find and buy. So don't spend tens of thousands of dollars unnecessarily. Use them better to have salt, have enough to make boiling water, prepare your food, decontaminate your house, and you need brushes. You need a lot of those little tools that are very simple, very inexpensive, to clean your house and soil and animals when you will prepare them, should something like that happen. Finally, and I should have said that earlier, how do you know there is fallout if no one is telling you that there's been a nuclear war going on? Have a Geiger counter. These are not very expensive. You probably can find some excellent ones around $100. Japanese models, Russian models are very inexpensive, very easy to use, and they will basically tell you if there is radiation where you point them. So if you point them on the soil, they will tell you what is the radiation level. And there is usually a little table that they give to you whether you find what is the dangerous levels. In the book, I give the tables as well. We give the tables of how dangerous the levels are for you, for your health. There is natural radiation, which usually is not dangerous for your health, but these items are useful to have. So have two or three, have one in your bag, one in your house. You know, these are important, maybe one in your house, because if they go off the charts, if they go very high very quickly, it means something has happened and no one has told you. So now you know, and now you can run and get prepared, put everything tight and start to decontaminate should some of those dust did enter your house. I also give in the book some of the examples of the experience from Ukraine and Belarus on how you can decontaminate your body should you have breathed in or should you have eaten contaminated dust. And there is hope that you can do it. There are elements, peptides, for example, is a chemical molecule that you find naturally in apples, for example. So eat a lot of apples, or you can store a little bit of these supplements, of peptide supplements, and they will bind with the radioactive atoms within your body, and your body will then eliminate them. So you don't want to keep that radioactive dust within you if you eventually had to breathe it in or somehow ingested it. So, you know, there's a lot of, it's a complex topic, but what I wanted to say is that building a shelter is not enough, and it's probably not necessary. And this is the key. So don't waste time and money on that necessarily, unless you're near a military base, which could be a target, in which case you could debate that and you can think of that. But definitely think of the other things, of the you know, do you have enough brooms, enough brushes? Do you have enough cleaning material? Do you have enough clothes that you can throw away after they are contaminated? Can you shut down your house, and so on and so on and so on? So all of these details, all of these items, I explain, of course, in the book. And I usually say we when I talk about the book. It's not the royal we. It's because I co-wrote the book with an expert on CBRN warfare, and he was a specialist, the head of the CBRN warfare for the French special anti-terrorist forces. So, yeah, and they are well respected around the world, these guys. So I think he knows what he's saying. So anyway, I hope this was useful. CBRN is available on Amazon. This is the hardcover version, expensive, but you have the paperback version, which is affordable, and I encourage you to get that, or on Kindle. It's a good book. Take care and prepare yourself, and if PGF watches this video, all my regards and respects. Take care.